Chairman. Dr. Nguyen, again, I want to thank you for being here. At the beginning of today's hearing, we put into the record an op-ed from the Baltimore Sun. The effects of opioid overprescription are evident in the emergency room. It's entitled. The author explains that one reason we are now seeing such a huge increase in heroin overdoses is because legal prescription painkillers are being overprescribed. She says, and I quote, "Once a patient is hooked, he or she often turns to street drugs, which can be easier and less expensive to acquire." And I think you all, just about everybody else, has said that this morning. Now, I want to be clear, I'm not trying to blame the doctors. They have a very difficult job. But Dr. Nguyen, do you agree that one reason we are seeing an uptick in heroin overdoses is because of the abuse of prescription opioids? Yes or no?
Yes.
The op-ed has a startling stat. It says, and I quote, "With only 5% of the world's population, we are consuming over 80% of the world's painkillers." The op-ed explains that drug companies are actively promoting this problem. It says, and I quote, "Prescriptions for opioids had been traditionally limited to cancer pain and comfort measures, but in the mid-90s, drug companies began marketing these pills as the solution to a new plethora of ailments. In their efforts to expand the market, producers understated and willfully ignored the powerfully addictive properties of their drugs." End of quote. Now, that sounds like drug companies are almost like drug pushers. The op-ed cites several examples. For instance, it says this, and I quote, "The promotion of OxyContin by Purdue Pharma was the most aggressive marketing of a Schedule II drug ever undertaken by a pharmaceutical company." Dr. Nguyen, this is big business. How in the world do we combat this massive and aggressive effort by drug companies? I mean, and you know, when they're making billions. Go ahead. I'm listening.
Congressman Cummings, thank you for asking that question. And I appreciate your saying that doctors want to do the right thing.
Mm-hmm.
We
Got
want
that.
To do the right thing. And actually, when we talk to our communities, our youth also recognize, if we ask our youth in schools, is heroin good or bad?
Mm-hmm.
They're going to say that heroin is bad. But we have a culture of excess. We have, because of the aggressive marketing of drug companies, we have this expectation that there should be a pill prescribed for every pain. This is what we have to change. So we have to make sure that doctors get the resources, the tools that they need, including prescription drug monitoring programs, including guidelines that can help with safe prescribing. But also, we need the resources when we're in the ER. We need the resources to connect our patients to treatment, because otherwise we also feel frustrated at knowing that our patients need care, but we can't deliver it to
now
them.
Now, you talked about some guidance you sent out. Does that guidance also include using painkillers that are not so addictive or not addictive at all?
Yes, our guidelines include three things. The first is the necessity of co-prescribing naloxone with any opioids, because somebody could die from this,
right.
So they should get that as well. The second is to be careful about the opioid medications, knowing that they are not first-line medications. They should only be prescribed for severe pain. And the third is for the danger of benzodiazepines, which are also killing our residents.
So the op-ed goes on to explain that why drug companies are doing this, and it's no surprise, it's about profit. It says the Sackler family, which owns Purdue Pharma, achieved a place on the Forbes 2015 list of America's wealthiest families. The Sacklers, the richest newcomers to the list, are worth an estimated $14 billion. That's appalling. And I call that blood money, because people are dying big time. I want to go back to something, Mr. Onomoto. And maybe some of the others of you all can answer this. Yesterday I was talking to a reporter, and he was saying that, Cummings, aren't you concerned that with even more money being requested for treatment and to deal with this problem, because there are so many more people getting into opioids and heroin, that money will be spread so thin that it will not have the kind of impact that you are hoping for.
Sure. So, you know, to your point, I think we have to have a comprehensive response to this. You know, and first and foremost, we need to rein in prescribing behavior in the United States. The Centers for Disease Control just put out recommendations last week that closely follow the guidance that Dr. Wen put out, because that is where we know is the significant driver to the problem. But we also know that despite all of our efforts, we still have too many people overdosing and dying, largely because they can't access treatment programs when they need treatment programs. And this is why that the President has put forward a significant proposal to expand treatment capacity in the United States. I hear this wherever I go. I just did a town hall forum in Toledo, Ohio, where the sheriff, I asked the sheriff what one single thing the federal government should be doing to address this opioid epidemic, and he didn't say we need more police officers. He said we need more treatment capacity because we're arresting too many people who haven't been able to access treatment. So we took a careful look at how many people need treatment and tried to adjust the proposal to really focus on making sure that as many people as possible had access to treatment when they needed it.
Just one more question. Dr. Wen, what happened? In other words, this was not a problem before, not as much of a problem, but then something happened. And can you tell me what happened? I mean, the numbers that the chairman cited, and I realize that people are moving from the opioids to the heroin, but what happened with regard to the opioids to get so many people on them and then for them to move to the heroin? Do you know?
My understanding is that there was aggressive marketing by drug companies so that the pain scale is something that's asked of every patient all the time in the course of their hospital stay. But the goal should not be getting to pain-free. The goal should be appropriate treatment. And yet, this is the expectation that's placed on patients and on doctors. And so doctors are put in a hard place, too, of satisfying those requirements when all of that was done for drug companies' benefit.
Mm-hmm. So doctors have a tough time. So in other words, the patient keeps coming in, and the pain could be at a 2, being the mildest. Chairman, I just used as much time as you had. Okay. The patient has a 2, and then he comes in, or she, and doesn't tell the truth, and says, I'm at a 9. Is that the kind of thing that happens?
That definitely happens, and then doctors feel that they have to get the patient's pain to 0, which includes overprescribing of narcotic painkillers in order to do so.
Wow. Ms. Bozzichello, you seem like you wanted to say something.
I do agree that we've set up an expectation whereby opioids are the first-line defense around pain therapies. And I think what we're trying to do through the guidance and through Dr. Wen is, particularly for people with chronic pain, that opioids are not the first-line defense to really substantially reduce pain, that we have to focus on other, and the evidence seems to be pretty strong that people who are on chronic pain don't have significantly better functioning when they're on opioids, that we need to be thinking about things like exercise and diet and cognitive behavioral therapy and non-opioid-based therapies, particularly for people with chronic pain.
Last question. What do you, Mr. Turner asked a critical question, Ms. Enomoto, when he talked about, I guess he was talking about treatment in prison, is that right? And what stops you from providing treatment in prison? Is that what he was asking you?
Yes.
Yeah. What? Yes. There's a regulation that says you can't do that?
Yes. And I guess I want to check into that so I can make sure I get you a complete and accurate.
Yeah, please do. Please do. Because I'm wondering if it's something that Congress should be dealing with. I don't know whether that's in your control or our control. You follow me?
Yes.
But I appreciate an answer as soon as. Do you know Mr. Botticelli?
I do not.
Okay.
I do not.
Thank you.